प्लीज मानिए सुरेश प्रभु जी।
सर मैं भी इस बिल के समर्थन में यहाँ खड़ा हूँ और हमारे हेल्थ कमेटी के चेयरमैन की हेल्थ ठीक हो ऐसी भी मैं ख्वाहिश करता हूँ। सर दिस बिल इज अ लॉन्ग ओवरड्यू पॉलिसी गैप दैट एग्जिस्टेड विच इज नाउ बीन करेक्टेड एंड देयरफॉर आई वांट टू कंग्रेचुलेट द ऑनरेबल मिनिस्टर। सर एज वी हैव सीन ऑल द हेल्थ प्रोफेशनल्स Finally, they deal with whom? They are dealing with a patient. And all their joint combined team effort results into addressing the health challenges of a patient. So if you may have a highest regulation for doctors, nurses and others, but if all those who are in this chain are not properly regulated, it may still risk the health of a patient. So ultimately, he is also former health minister of Odisha. So end of the day, it is extremely critical that all those who are involved into the healthcare dispensing delivery should all be brought under a regulation. And therefore, I congratulate my friend the minister, because over a period of time, we are seeing that health sector is getting regulated, but also regulated in a way that it should progress more. So always the twin challenge of regulation is that if you don't regulate, you are exposing yourself to the risk. But if you over-regulate, there is a challenge that regulation will happen, but no results will be produced. So I think this is a very important issue, and therefore I really wish to congratulate you for bringing this important bill. So number one, I would like to make some suggestions also. Firstly, this constitution of commission is a welcome step, because who will regulate? When you say regulation has to happen, somebody has to, there has to be a regulator. So constitution of commission is a very welcome step. At the same time, I would request the minister to look at it, that a commission should not have any omission in terms of people who should be really part of offering this healthcare system should be more in numbers than those who are in the government. Because government has to regulate, good job they have to do. But they are not the ones who are going to actually offer the services. And therefore, I think you should try to always keep in mind that a ratio of people who are from the government as policymakers and those who are actually going to deliver these services, is the ratio should be not adversely not against those who are professionals. I think this particular bill actually is talking about it, but I personally feel it should really happen. So secondly, the professional councils, which you have said will be appointed by the commission. I think professional council, by definition, should be a self-regulatory body. The professionals, like doctors, they have Indian Medical Association, there are other nurses council, but they are regulators. But I feel that new professions that are going to be created, lab technician, others, you first encourage them to form their own council. If they don't have the council, how will they be represented in this body? So first and foremost, it is very important that you must start from the grassroots, make sure that these professionals will have their own council, and I think there will be election eventually, so that by election they can be nominated or could be part of this council. I think it is also very important, and that's what I was mentioning about the role of regulation. See, there are many functions which have been very elaborated. I really feel it's very elaborated provision about it.
माननीय सुरेश प्रभु जी, माननीय सुरेश प्रभु, 6 बज गए हैं।
दिस इज अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट लेजिस्लेशन दैट वी आर डिस्कसिंग एंड देर इज अ ब्रॉड लेवल ऑफ कॉन्सेंसस ऑल्सो सो आई प्रपोज दैट वी मे सिट टिल द बिल इज डिस्पोज्ड ऑफ एंड देन डिस्पर्स द फॉर द डे एडजॉर्न फॉर द डे।
तो बिल खत्म होने तक हम सब बैठेंगे, यह आम सहमति सदन की है।
करते हैं बिल इज डिस्पोज्ड ऑफ, बिल इज पास्ट, नॉट डिस्पोज्ड ऑफ।
राइट, माननीय सुरेश प्रभु जी,
हाउ टू डिस्पोज, दैट्स
व्हाट, माननीय सुरेश प्रभु जी,
व्हाट Mr. Jairam Ramesh was saying that he has already decided to pass the bill, so don't call it dispose of, it is going to be passed anyway. So that's what he was mentioning.
Please continue.
I was talking about the substantive provision about the commission and the role of the commission, the responsibility of the commission. Mr. Minister, one part that should be mentioned here is how to increase the number of professionals. The regulator's job should be make quality into regulation posture so that all these professionals will be highly regulated. But how will you increase the number of people who will be coming out in the market? If that doesn't happen, it doesn't succeed. So I think the job of the commission should also be to promotion. The promotional aspect of that should also be mentioned so that eventually it will be the response of the commission that over a period of time we have many more numbers. And I'm mentioning this because you mentioned in the object of the bill that 40 million new jobs will be created in the healthcare sector. 40 million jobs as per the WHO's own estimate. If so many members are going to be needed, then if you don't increase the number through a process, how will it going to succeed? So I think this is very important that you must ensure that a commission will be mandated with the responsibility of doing quality education, quality of professionals, at the same time, number of professionals also should be increased over a period of time. I think there is a, obviously, rightly so, there is a state as well as a central council. And the state will register a professional, and then central will, again, through a process, will actually put it in the, that body. I think now with the technology, now you are doing such a great job in dispensing vaccine through a proper digital space. So why do you need twice that one state registers, again will go through a process to, before a central register accommodate this number? I think we should have a seamless process wherein once a state registers, you should automatically get into that with proper system. But that system can be digital, so that there is no need time, it can happen without any difficulty. So there is another issue, and that's what we are talking about, that there is a possibility that our professionals will be able to serve globally. And there's a global demand, so our people will be able to go. But the problem that happens is on the mobility. The other countries do not recognize our qualification. They do not allow our professionals to go and work there. This is happening even with doctors. Now forget the professionals, healthcare professionals. So how do you make sure that we must aggressively ensure that our professionals will be able to find jobs, their recognition will happen properly, qualification, and therefore we should try to work on it in a proper way. We have already said that some professionals will not be able to practice unless now under the new law they will be registered. Mr. Minister, I was just wondering, one category that you mentioned is researchers. I was just wondering, why should researchers, if he's not registered, he should not be able to practice? Research is an open-ended thing. I understand in case of laboratory technicians, in case of paramedics, every other person, that unless he's registered, he's not able to practice. But why should a researcher, if he's not registered, why he cannot do research? Because research is an activity which is not going to affect anybody, which is not going to have a healthcare-related issue. So I think this, again, aspect, you may please look into that so that it will not result into this. I also welcome a provision wherein a healthcare professional will be able to earn credits of 3,600 hours over a period of 3 to 6 years. This is a very important and I would say very welcoming idea that he should keep earning credit as he go along. So he should not leave his job and go and work in an institution and then come back and try to do this. I think it's a very welcome thing, and therefore I think we should try to use this now in other areas as well. I would like to draw your attention to some very interesting issues. Like, for example, Clause 40, which says that unless, now once this law is notified, when the councils are formed, and then unless your register will not be able to do this, and any institution will not be able to impart any courses of this kind unless they are registered. But sir, just imagine, all states, though they are saying the word use is shall, that states shall form a council. But some states fail to form a council. What happens to those institutions? How will they be able to work? Though there is a provision clause, you have mentioned it already, clause 41B, Roman 2, you have mentioned that there will be some provision. I think there is need to be a clarity, otherwise there will be a problem. that some states may not have proper council. How these institutions are already functioning will be able to work. So I think we should really be able to take care of that. Also, that is 41B, Roman 3. So I think this really needs to look into that properly. Also, I feel that your whole idea is to offer low-cost healthcare, low-cost education. The whole problem comes in terms of infrastructure that is necessary. Now, infrastructure for institution is very important. We should not compromise on that at all. That so many square feet areas, so many laboratories, all of the things are really necessary. But why that same infrastructure cannot be used in, say, night duty and day duty? Some institution may like to run it twice. Some may run nursing college in the morning, may run paramedical course in the evening. Why should there be a problem? But I think today's regulation does not allow it, which unnecessarily put additional cost on it. So I would request you to please look into this. This will actually help in addressing a real challenge in the rural areas, and particularly now, if educational institutions is going to invest more into infrastructure, obviously they're going to recover it from the fees. That's the only way it will happen. Why should we unnecessarily burden a student by paying additional cost? I think we should try to work on it. I personally feel I have gone through the bill properly, but still I feel there could be a gray area. What happens to the existing practicing professionals? Because you are saying that no professional unless registered will be able to do this. So what happens to current ones who may not have undergone so many hours of courses? What do that happens to them? I think you really need to protect them properly. Also make sure that you issue some sort of, maybe they will have to require to do some additional refreshing courses. This is quite understandable. It's a good idea also. They'll be able to refresh the knowledge. But make it clear, maybe in the rules, so that this type of a situation will really not arise. I feel we really now need to move on online kind of courses. So we should not say that this so many hours of credit that they should obtain, most of it could be obtained online. Practical training is a different thing. For practical training, of course, you have to go to the hospital or you have to go to a nursing home. But many of these courses, many of these credits can be obtained online, including I would feel that all the permissions that this commission, the councils are supposed to give, all of that should be transparent and online, which will only ensure that more and more institutions will get registered, more and more people will be able to do that. In fact, sir, we should be proud of the fact that India is the single largest recipient of remittances in the world. We receive highest remittances in the world, more than $82 billion. In fact, our MOS should be happy, as well as Mr. Vishwam sitting next to him, that Kerala contributes significantly to it. Because of workers, when they go abroad, they send money back. Sir, imagine the healthcare professionals, how much more they can bring it back to India. This is a great potential. But to do that, while we are regulating it, we should do it in such a way that there will be a promotional aspect to it, so that more and more people will be able to get into this and will do that. And sir, my one suggestion, that like abbreviations, like the doctors are called doctors, you know, advocates are called advocates, the lawyers are called advocates, chartered accountants called CAs, there is everybody. Because you are creating this new category of professionals, think about an abbreviation for them, so that there will be a sense of identity. They will feel privileged that I am HCO, healthcare professional, something like that, HCP maybe. But something like that, which will actually ensure that there will be a dignity for them into the society. So they will be seen like a doctors of a different kind, and when they'll go out, they will also walk on the street with a lot of respect, and I think that itself will help other people to come into this field. So our problem in India, sir, a plumber is not recognized as somebody great, but an engineer is recognized as somebody great, whereas plumber provides more facilities to a household than an engineer. We hardly comes to the house anyway. So I think this is very important, that we must move towards providing dignity of labor to all the professionals, and in healthcare, it's a pyramid. So doctor is at the top, the super specialty doctor is on the super top, but the pyramid cannot be standing on its own strength unless these healthcare professionals who are bulk and the most important foundation of the healthcare system. So I really welcome this, and I once again congratulate the minister for many things, including how you are handling COVID, but I'm sure you will be able to take this process forward, create a new regime in which our healthcare professionals will be able to not only work in India and offer better healthcare services, but will be able to go abroad as ambassadors of India, send money back home, and in the process will be able to create even more employment for the people. So I really wish to congratulate the minister. Thank you very much, sir, for giving me time. And I'm sure, again I say, but my friend has gone, that wishing him good health. Thank you.
Dhanyavaad, Maniya Suresh Prabhu ji.